Welcome to Popternative, where we dive into topical discussions from the worlds of pop culture, social media, and sports. Here is your host, Peter Remoliotis, a.k.a. PD Beats.
Hello and welcome to Popternative. This is the web show where we have digital dialogues from the worlds of social media, sports, and pop culture. The second one was sports, and this is our hashtag SM Sports special. We're going to be talking about social media and how it relates to sports, and we're also going to specifically talk about live video content streaming and different strategies that sports teams and athletes can use in the digital age. So I'm quickly going to introduce the panel. First, we have the CEO and founder of Front Office Sports, Adam White, is with us on Popternative. Adam, welcome to the show.
Hey, thanks, Peter. It's a pleasure to be here. Excited, looking forward to it. Really big fan of your work.
Thank you. No, I'm a big fan of Front Office Sports. We'll get to that soon. We also have the Director of Public Relations for Adidas US, Michael Ehrlich, is with us. Michael, welcome to Popternative.
Thanks for having me. Excited to be here and excited to chat with all you guys tonight.
Great. I'm excited as well. And last but not least, we have a producer at ESPN, Jason Romano, is with us. Jason, welcome to the show.
It's great to be here. Thanks for having me.
No problem. So very quickly, this is where we have, you know, opening remarks. We go around the horn, and you guys give us a little bit of information about yourselves, about your work. So quickly, Adam, why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself and Front Office Sports? What's that all about?
Yeah, so Front Office Sports is an emerging multimedia publishing platform of sports business news, career advice, education, looking to be a real leading edge resource for people who are looking for 21st century news in a very digital focused way. And so, yeah, that came about 2 years ago now. We've been doing it for 2 years, had a lot of good stuff. We just got to 29 people working on the site, which is awesome. And personally, myself, I'm just finishing up my last year here at University of Miami. I'm headed back down there tomorrow, actually, and going to spend my senior year there and finish up and see what else is next in the real world. But yeah, that's kind of a little bit about myself and Front Office Sports.
Great. Well, you and Russell and everyone else at Front Office Sports should be really proud about what you guys are doing. It's a really cool thing. So I'm happy to have you on. We've been trying to get you on for a while.
Yeah.
You made it happen.
So. Yeah, finally, at the right time. I appreciate it.
No problem. And from Adidas US, Michael Ehrlich is with us. Michael Ehrlich is the Director of Public Relations. Michael, public relations, kind of vague. Can you just specifically tell us about, you know, the day-to-day operations of what you specifically do?
Yeah, absolutely. I work for Adidas, an emerging sports brand here in the US. I sit within our Portland-based newsroom. Portland is home to our US headquarters. And within the newsroom combines the public relations team, which I manage, across both sport and style, so everything from football and basketball to originals, neo, action sports. Sitting alongside of my team in the newsroom is our social media team, which includes social strategists and community managers, and in addition to that, we have an analytics team as well. So all sitting within one roof, and really with the goal of being the most talked about brand in the industry.
Very cool. Well, we're really happy to have you out. I really really appreciate you taking the time. It's really cool to get insight from guys like you that work for these really big sports brands on the show. So I really appreciate you coming on.
Yeah, of course, my pleasure.
And of course, we have Jason Romano from ESPN. Jason, you work you're a producer on the Mike and Mike show. That's correct.
Yes, I work and handle and oversee all of their social media on the show.
Very cool. And how is that? There must be a lot of stuff to handle for a show of that capacity.
Yeah, I've been doing social media for, I guess this would be my fifth season, 4 years. And I've been at ESPN 16 years. And Mike and Mike's show is unlike any other at ESPN. It's got 4 hours of content daily, every day. And my job is to not only be a social strategist or producer during the show, but also to keep the content rolling throughout the day, and it's become a multi-platform type show. It's not just a radio show anymore or even a television show. We're talking about a digital and social presence that is almost just as large as the audience that we have on TV and radio. So it's quite the fun, quite the endeavor, and I've been having a blast on the show.
No, and that's great that you brought that up, because that leads to the first topic. Or, you know, you look at situations in sports when, you know, there are certain months of the year that there's a lot going on and there's a lot of content being pumped out. And we kind of have this social media sports hashtag, which lets us kind of, you know, see what's going on and kind of keep track of everything. But, you know, you look at an example, you know, with a big event, whether it's, you know, the Olympics, whether it's the Super Bowl, there's going to be a lot of attention on those events, and there's going to be all these little things. What kind of strategies, and Michael, we can start with you, what kind of strategies can we use in general to, you know, make sure that, you know, as much content gets, you know, the exposure that it needs? Or how do we kind of avoid saturation when we're creating strategies of when to post things and when not to post things?
Yeah, that's a great question. And obviously, as the PR, the storytelling, the editorial landscape continues to change, it really is all about social and really leveraging that all the new platforms as our storytelling vehicles. And to borrow a quote from my colleague at Adidas, Jeremy Darlow, it's easier to crash a party than it is to throw a party. So really leveraging both sport and culture moments to try and break through the clutter with disruptive content, disruptive storytelling and messaging, and really leveraging the eyeballs that are on these sporting events to tell your brand message, especially when you're not even associated with the event, really crashing that party.
Mm-hmm. Adam, what do you think about that, the digital storytelling and making sure that as much as possible things get, you know, seen? Front Office Sports is pumping out content on the daily. I see it. I go through it all. What do you think about that?
I mean, just for us, it's really about creating powerful content. That's going to be the content that's going to be seen, the engaging stuff, the personal stuff that people can relate with. You know, we've had a lot of good success with the partnership we have with Gen Y Digital, and they've done like a From the Experts piece. And it's, you know, a really, you know, heartfelt type thing, really going back and talking about their career. And then just our personal interviews and those behind the scenes type things that people can relate and really want to read. Like, that's going to cut through the clutter. There's going to be so much content out there. There's always going to be, you know, something about this story. There's always going to be something about this story. But when you go in depth and you find a real personal touch to the story, and you get them to open up about their experiences and what's been good and what's been bad, you know, that's where we find a lot of success, finding our content, getting through the clutter of a lot of the other content that's out there.
Mm-hmm. And Jason, with your experience with Mike and Mike, how, like Adam mentioned clutter, how do you go on from the day-to-day basis making sure that the proper things get posted and, you know, the proper things are being monitored?
Yeah, I think the key, and it's echoing what these guys have said, Adam and Mike have both said, content has always been the key. You know, 16 years at ESPN, it's always been about the content, even before there was social media. So if it's good content, we believe it's going to cut through. I also think that it's a matter of sort of striking while the iron's hot. And I think Mike said it, crashing a party is just as vital as throwing your own. And we try to throw our own. I think we have large enough platforms, especially with my colleagues and a lot of the different social handles that ESPN has, to be able to throw our own party. But when there are things happening, we need to crash that party as well and be in there. And I think for Mike and Mike, it's a little different because the show is on from 6 to 10 in the morning, and sports aren't happening in the morning. So they're talking about what happened last night. So you're, a lot of times you're crashing the party and trying to catch fans up, not only on what happened the night before, most of them go to bed knowing what happened, but kind of reminding them and bringing up, it's almost like being a newspaper for them in the modern age. And obviously a lot of people treat their feeds like their newspapers. So we're trying to kind of cut through in that mold in the morning. And we see a high engagement in the morning. We certainly don't see the engagement you would see at night when people are sitting at home watching shows, watching games, et cetera. But you see a high engagement in the morning waking up, especially on Instagram. I see it the most. And that's where we try to really put our best stuff, as you know, video is huge, and I'm sure we'll get into that. But we're really trying to take advantage of what the guys say on the air, taking that content, bringing it to the digital space and to the social space, but really taking advantage of video. That's the big mm-hmm. thing here. And I know you're going to ask about that, so I won't go too much further in depth. Yeah. But video has been a driving force.
Mm-hmm. Oh, absolutely. And, you know, you mentioned Instagram, and it's true. Instagram content is the most powerful thing. My sister and I, you know, a couple years ago, we started an Instagram account for our dog, and we have about 158,000 followers for him, which is a very big number.
Can I borrow some of those followers?
Yeah, right.
It's just, wow. But it, yeah, it's pretty crazy. Little Leo the Morkey, for anyone who wants to check it out. He's 5 pounds of fury, and he's awesome. But it's unbelievable, all that stuff that gets popped out. And Michael, you mentioned, you know, Jeremy Darlow, and I'm a big fan of his work. You know, he's written a book, which I think is really awesome about branding and championships. And you see the type of things that he's posting and the type of things that you're posting. And this segues to the perfect, my next question about live video, live streaming. Like, what we're doing right now is live video chatting, right? This is something that I think is going to be going to take the world by storm. We're seeing a lot of people trying to properly accomplish it. What are your perspectives? Because this is new, like Facebook Live, Periscope. It's not old yet. You can't say it's still emerging. So Michael, from your like experience with like live video streaming, what do you think about it so far? What are kind of the things that you like about it? What are some of the things that you want to grow about it?
Yeah, I mean, I think it mirrors sort of the storytelling industry as a whole, and it is evolving each and every day. And obviously with Instagram Stories launching recently, it just keeps evolving, and there are more tools out there and more platforms. I think consumers, I think kids, I think athletes today are more brand conscious than they've ever been before. And I think that extends not only to brands such as the one that I work for, but their personal brand as well. And I think live video is the perfect platform for brands, for athletes, for politicians, for celebrities to really share their personality, to share their key messaging. And I think what's great about live video, and I think, you know, it sort of is a gift and a curse for branding folks, is you can't fake it. Obviously with content, you can edit it, you can filter it, but with live video, it really is authentic. And I think that is key for storytelling. I think that's key for brand building on the personal side and the professional side. And I think as we've seen this summer, with everything Facebook's doing, with everything Instagram's doing in particular, I mean, I think it's going to change each and every day. And as sports, social media professionals, we just have to keep our eyes open and really trial and error and see what works and what the biggest challenges might be in the future.
Jason, are you working with Facebook Live or live video streaming at all, experimenting with that during Mike and Mike at all?
Yeah, we've done a little bit. The key, what we don't want to do is we don't want to take away the experience of the actual broadcast. Mm-hmm. So I don't want to just live stream the show when you can watch it on TV and you can watch it or listen to it on the radio or whatever. So we don't want to take away the live element of what that show is trying to do as a broadcast piece of content. But we have done a couple Facebook Lives. Molly Karam, who hosts First Take, also is a part of Mike and Mike's show on the TV side from 8 to 10 a.m. Eastern. And we've done a couple Facebook Lives with Molly. We had John Sally filling in for Mike Golic one day, and we did a Facebook Live with John Sally interviewing Carl Anthony Towns. This was back in late June, right around the draft time. And we saw high engagement. I mean, Facebook, listen, their algorithm recognizes the live video streaming side of things. And I don't know if they juice it or if they're just more people are seeing it on their feeds, but the engagement's much higher. Mm-hmm. And we saw at least 2 or 3x engagement when we went Facebook Live. So it's definitely, we were trying it. We hadn't done a ton of these, so I really wasn't quite sure, you know, how do we want to shoot it? Do we want to have it be in the studio? Do we want to go into like a green room area or just kind of in behind the scenes type place? But we've seen really high engagement and we're planning on doing more. We just haven't figured out exactly what or when that is yet, especially with the mics. We haven't done anything with them yet. And, mm-hmm. you know, we're working on trying to see if we can bring them into the fold over the next few months or so.
But that's what I'm saying. It's very new. And Adam, you know, I've seen, you know, some front office sports articles touch on, you know, the emerging platform that is live Facebook Live or Periscope. Are you a fan of where this is heading? And what do you think about, you know, athletes? Should athletes be using it specifically because sports teams are capitalizing it? What about the athletes? What's your take on all of this?
Yeah, I'm a huge fan. We don't personally use it ourselves as of yet. We've kind of done some, you know, Snapchat stuff, which is more like a semi-live thing. You know, if they can catch it right away, it's kind of live, but, you know, most people catch it when they're sitting down somewhere. So it's more like a semi-live platform. But yeah, I'm a huge fan just in terms of, like, when you look at the brands. And I was at an event earlier this year, and they're talking about how brands no longer want to be an insert here sponsor. Brands want to create content, and that's the kind of stuff that they want to do when they're working these sponsorships. So for them going forward, I mean, it's just huge. And you see any of these other types of platforms like Uninterrupted, where you're having these personal conversations with players, it just gives the audience and the people who are consuming this content just such another layer that they can feel like they're really in touch with these athletes. And I mean, that's, I think that's a huge thing for teams and everything like that, because the more in touch the fans feel with whatever it is, whether it's a TV show, whether it's a, you know, a game, whether it's a team, the more in touch they feel, the more loyal they're going to be. So if there's any type of bad things, if there's any, you know, if a team goes 10-7, or you know, next year goes 2-3. You know, I mean, what the fact is that if they can feel that connection and they can feel that personality, you know, through the Facebook Live, whatever it may be, it's huge for everyone across the board.
Mm-hmm. No, that for sure is something, and I'm really curious to see how it's going to change. And it was mentioned, you know, Michael, I think you were the one that mentioned the Instagram stories.
Yep.
Yeah. What do you think about that? Because I understand, you know, Instagram, Snapchat, you know, they're competing head on. But what do you, like, I don't see much similarity. I don't see much differences between what Snapchat had and what Instagram has. I was excited to find out there were stories and I used it. And I don't know if I'm missing something, but they look very, like, it's the same thing.
Yeah, I mean, obviously there are obvious similarities, but I think in the last week, you know, you look at the stats and you look at how brands have activated, you look how teams and personal brands and athletes have activated, and the numbers are staggering, and the reach of Instagram stories overall is it speaks for itself. So I think the future is certainly bright there. And, you know, as I said earlier, with any of these platforms that we've spoken about, you know, they're going to evolve. They're going to continue to evolve. The user base is going to evolve. And I think it's just going to continue to change each and every day. So, you know, as professionals, the more experience we can get on each platform, the, you know, what we can try new things and just really see what the opportunities are, the better.
Oh, absolutely. And Jason, you also mentioned, like, Facebook video is a monster. It is the algorithm. Absolutely. It's a monster. You know, Popturative is on YouTube, and I'll post something on YouTube, and I'll post it on Facebook Live, and there are different views. Like the Facebook views just knock it, like, blow them out of the water on YouTube. And I think is it safe to say that we're gonna be in a, you know, we're in a social media age now, but we will be in a live video age. Like, that will be something that will define our era at one point.
Absolutely. It would not shock me if that comes very soon. It's already coming. I mean, you saw Chewbacca Lady and what she did on Facebook 2 months ago. And I don't remember how many views, but it was in the hundreds of millions, if I remember correctly. It's gigantic. Mm-hmm. Most viewed Facebook video post ever. And that was all from Facebook Live. And she became an instant celebrity and probably built her own platform based upon one silly video of a purchase she made at Target. And it just shows you the idea of the power of video. And I think native video on all the platforms are the new wave of where it's going. And we're all trying to figure out the best way to navigate those waters and to use those, that type of posting. But I will say this, the Facebook Live tool, when you have 1 billion users daily, and they have the most users by far, as you guys all know, than any of the platforms. And yes, it skews older, et cetera, and younger people are still navigating towards Snapchat and even away from Instagram a little bit. But when you have that many users and you can reach that many people, man, you better be there. And I say that even to young professionals who are just coming out of college and they're like, oh, Facebook is so, you know, 2008 or whatever. It's like, they're not. With the video and with the amount of people that are there, you have to be on those platforms. And the same with Twitter and Instagram, obviously, and the video that they've, you know, adapted into their algorithm, into their feeds and their platforms. But video is where it's at. And Facebook Live, I can just see that continuing to get bigger and bigger. I mean, even the Olympics are signing deals to put out live content on Facebook Live. You can watch some basketball games on there, I saw recently. That's insane. And you can just go to Facebook and watch a game right there.
The NHL is going to be live streaming games on Twitter this year.
Saw that as well. And the NFL is live streaming the game this year as well on Twitter. So
yeah, and was it NFL? And also, you know, Snapchat, it's not necessarily, you know, live video streaming, but that's kind of like the behind the scenes. And I think, is that the NFL who has that big deal? Someone has a big deal with Snapchat. Yeah. Is that the NFL? Mm-hmm. So, yeah, you know, that season's coming. It's going to be unbelievable to see what they're going to come up with.
And like, you're going to see a lot of these brands in take Snapchat and kind of develop these sort of mini episodes on Snapchat. I think you're going to see not just from a sports brand, but I saw recently some live reality shows are going to be developing what they call Snapchat shows, like little miniature shows of what their brand is on television for Snapchat. So you're going to see a lot of people there, especially trying to reach the younger audience.
Mm-hmm. Michael, can you speak to that, comment on that, what Jason just said about, you know, the Snapchat audiences? I find that really interesting.
Yeah, absolutely. And obviously it skews younger, but at the same time, it's a platform that allows brands, allows teams, allows schools to really give their fans, their consumers, inside access and a different look than you're going to get on any other platform. And obviously, as we all know, the content that appears on Twitter is not the same content that goes on Instagram or that goes on Facebook. So it really depends on the platform, but they all work in unison and really offer opportunities for personal brand building and professional, and, you know, all the way from the top levels of, you know, NFL or NBA, all the way down to high school personal brands as well.
Perfect. No, that's really good. Well, I think we're gonna wrap up this episode, but very quickly before I want to go, I just want to go. So Front Office Sports and Popternative have very similar their mandates, or I think both of us, like, I made Popternative, and I think Adam made Front Office Sports for a very, like, for many reasons, but one similar reason is to kind of pay it forward and create content for, you know, the students that really want to work in, you know, social media, sports, and entertainment, and kind of have, you know, because we have a lot of people from the social media sports world on Popternative, like yourselves, that are like pros in the field that give, you know, advice and give tips about things, and Front Office Sports pump out an abundance amount of the content about that. So I just wanted to ask, you know, Michael, Jason, and Adam, you can also, you'll chime in as well.
Yeah.
What advice, Michael and Jason, do you have for students or people that want to work in social media, sports, business? Like, what can you give them, like, right now that can kind of help their career?
Mike, go ahead.
Yeah, I mean, I think social is the perfect platform to, again, build your personal brand and build your network. And I think, you know, when I was in college, we didn't have the sort of endless network that we have now where you can reach out to an Adam or a Jason on Twitter and get to know them and pick their brain and take part in Q&As and Twitter chats and obviously live streams like we're doing now. And it really is sort of such a vast ocean of opportunities. And I think as a student, as a young professional, I think leveraging your personal brand, building it on social and really networking as much as you can, it really goes a long way. And, you know, our summer intern right now, he's amazing. He, you know, DM'd me almost a year ago about inquiring about opportunities with the brand. And it really, you know, stands out and, again, breaks through that clutter and really makes your personal brand stand out in the industry.
Absolutely. Jason, what about you?
Yeah, I mean, the biggest thing is network. And I think there's no excuse. They, you know, a lot of these younger college kids have grown up in the social media era. So be on there, establish your platform on there. But remember, as you're trying to get jobs, that people are looking at your feeds and they want to make sure that you're not putting things out there that is going to be a detriment to the company that might want to hire you. And so to represent yourself in a way, yeah, you can have fun and be silly and be, you know, poking fun at people and just putting up funny memes and all that kind of stuff. But make sure you're not putting anything too inappropriate out there. That's a big one for me. But also networking and making sure that you are connecting with the people. Find the people that are doing the job that you want to do and connect with them. There's no excuse in this age to find the person who's doing a job that you desire to have someday. And never ask for a job in a lot of ways. This might sound kind of crazy, but always just ask for advice, you know, and don't try to connect with somebody because you're looking to get a job from them. Connect with somebody because you want to truly build a relationship and just gain as much wisdom as possible. I think that's important. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. No, absolutely. And Adam, what have you learned over these past couple of years, you know, especially like with Front Office Sports? I mean, there's a lot, but like, what could you, you know, tell everyone from what from your personal experience, because you're still learning. You're learning every day. You know, what would you say?
Yeah, I mean, you just can't be afraid to use the platforms and kind of use them and leverage them as powerful as you can make it. I mean, I know with FOS and with my personal brand, you know, we've built everything through the social channels. I met Michael through the social channels, and you know, him and I now have a great relationship. We can reach out to each other whenever we really want to and kind of run down things or talk about things or get scoops. You know, it's that kind of thing that if you just kind of go out there and make sure that you're reaching out for the right reasons, like Jason commented on, and like actually wanting to get to know the people, you can get to know people so easily through social, because a lot of the times they're sharing stuff that's telling you about them. So if you go to them and you can see like what's on their feed, and they're like, oh, maybe they love baseball. So now you know that they love baseball. So you can approach them in that and talk to them about that and just create like a genuine relationship like you would as a friend. You know, some of these people who I've actually never met in person, I feel like I'm friends with. You know, like Peter, we've talked over Twitter, but we've talked about real things. We've had a real relationship. It hasn't just been like random things every once in a while. It's been, you know, good conversations. I feel like I could be, you know, you're a friend. And same with Michael.
Yeah.
It's that type of thing that if you can really go out there and take it as not a you first, but like a them first, and like really get to know them and really see what they're doing. And that's like what with FOS is, we kind of built a brand around that, is see what they're doing and then let them tell you everything you need to know and then go from there. Honestly, it's as simple as that.
Authenticity, yeah. That's the key. Yeah,
absolutely.
We've had over 40 episodes of Pop Turnative, and I would like easily say that over 85% of the guests that I've had on, I've connected with them through social.
Yeah.
Yep.
And it works. If you don't ask, you know, worst comes to worst, there's a no.
Yep.
But if you never ask, you might not get that yes that's sitting right there.
Yeah.
So it's really interesting. And
it's not even just like Twitter and those things. I mean, I know LinkedIn is so powerful, just even that reaching out to that. And you have to leverage LinkedIn as much as you can. You know, when we first started, I just put in a sports business group, hey, this is what I'm doing. I'm interviewing professionals. We'd love to hear from you. And I got 6 people to respond, and you know, we went from there. And it's those type of things that if you, again, are authentic and show the people that you really care about learning and that you're not just someone who's like, oh, how can you give me a job, or oh, I want to talk to you so I can get to someone else. Like that, people are going to sniff that out right away. And as soon as they find out about that, they're going to tell everyone that's how you are, and you just close every single door.
No, I absolutely. And I think we're out of time, but this has been amazing. I hope you guys have had fun. Adam, thank you so much for coming on the show. I really appreciate it. I'm a really big fan of Front Office Sports. It's a really good platform.
Thanks,
so
man. I appreciate it.
I really hope it's like the exposure for it is growing every day, and I hope it doesn't stop, man. It's you keep going, keep hustling. I love it.
Thanks,
Michael.
Brother.
Thank you so much for coming on the show. I really appreciate it.
Of course, anytime, man. Appreciate it.
And Jason, it was amazing, incredible to have you on. So thank you so much.
My pleasure, man. Anytime. Thanks.
Yeah, thanks, Peter. It's been awesome, man.
No problem. Well, this has been Popturnative. You can catch previous episode of Popturnative on our YouTube page. You could follow us on Twitter and like us on Facebook. Thank you, everyone, and have a good night.
Thank you for tuning in to Popturnative. Make sure to check out our past episodes of Popturnative on YouTube. Be sure to like Popturnative on Facebook and follow us on Twitter. Thank you for tuning in to Popternative. Make sure to check out our past episodes of Popternative on YouTube. Be sure to like Popternative on Facebook and follow us on Twitter.